Thanks.
Good midday to all of you indeed. My name is Mikko and I hunt hackers. That's my job. I've been hunting hackers before the internet became commonplace, but for the last 30 years, I've been hunting hackers on the internet. And when the internet came around 30 years ago, when the World Wide Web was invented, initially it looked like and felt like utopia. Like now we have this global network where geography no longer matters. It doesn't matter where you are, there's no distance anymore, there's no borders, there is no geography. And naively, we were thinking how it's going to change the world for the better, how there will no longer be crises and conflicts, because now anybody can be in direct contact with anyone else and we get to know each other better. But as we all realize by now, the internet wasn't a dream. It wasn't the utopia. It turned out to be, in many ways, closer to a nightmare. A nightmare where today wars are fought on the internet, elections are won and lost based on information operations, where online criminals are running rampant, and where people are so dependent on their social networks they spend 24 hours a day on Facebook clicking the refresh button. And indeed, we are already very close to a time where it's now more likely for us to become a victim of a crime in the online world instead of the real world. So who are these attackers that we see targeting our systems, breaking into our home computers and our devices, and causing data breaches at our companies? Like, who are the hackers? We have a very abstract notion of a hacker. We typically think about some movie villains or people with their hoodies sitting at a keyboard, when the true reality is that we have quite different selection of different kinds of hackers out there on the internet. Starting from guys in their tracksuits. This is Charlie, this is Chris, they're both hackers. They're also both friends of mine, because these guys are white hat hackers, hackers who break security to increase security. They're mostly famous for hacking into cars, vehicle systems, including the Chrysler Jeep systems, which they were able to completely take over remotely. They could gain access to a car, lock the doors, disable the brake, and floor the gas. Which sounds really, really bad. So it's really nice that this innovation, this finding was done by good hackers, guys who did it so they could report it to the car manufacturers. And in this particular case, Chrysler did one of the largest vehicle recalls over the last 30 years to fix these particular vulnerabilities, which means we're all safer on the roads thanks to these hackers. But then, of course, there are hackers who actually break the laws. Hacktivists and criminals who break the laws either for a political purpose or a protest purpose or to make money. And money is a good motive. I suppose I don't have to tell this to you, but money is a good motive. People do all kinds of things to make money. And if you can become a millionaire by writing viruses, it's no surprise that someone will do it. Then we have governmental attackers and more extremism and terrorist groups to worry about as source of online attacks. However, looking at the amount of attacks that we analyze in our labs at F-Secure, the vast majority of the attacks are coming from criminals. Group number three, criminals who do it to make money. Criminals like these. This is Dmitry Fedorov, this is Viljar Kivi, this is Yevgeny Bogachev. Dmitry made his money online with different kinds of botnet operations. Viljar did his money with phishing attacks targeting financial systems. And Yevgeny is the head of the Zeus botnet, one of the largest banking Trojan botnets we've ever seen. Dmitry and Viljar were both caught. They've actually both been sentenced. Yevgeny has, so far, still hasn't been caught. In fact, if you go to both Europol and Interpol pages, you'll find Yevgeny from the most wanted pages, where he's wanted for international money laundering, cybercrime, and most likely also for crimes against good taste. Like, what the hell is that? So, cybercrime millionaires, do they really exist? Well, yes, they do. There's multiple different organized crime gangs operating from different parts of the world, making millions and millions with ransom trojans, banking trojans, credit card theft, with botnets, with password theft, any mechanism that you might be able to imagine how somebody would be able to steal money on the internet, it's highly likely someone is already doing it. When you go to the deep web or Tor hidden services, you'll find criminals selling exploit kits, selling access to criminal botnets, selling stolen credit cards, selling skimming devices. And all of this trade, of course, is being done with, well, what do you think? With cryptocurrencies. With bitcoins, Ethereum, with Monero, with Zcash, which is the equivalent of cash in the online world. Now, real-world criminals love cash. For example, drug trade is done with cash. If you go to the streets and want to buy cocaine, you can't pay with a credit card, or so I've been told. Exactly in the same way, when you want to buy stolen credit cards from a deep Tor hidden service site, well, you can't use a credit card either. You pay with Bitcoin, or nowadays, more likely, you pay with Zcash or Monero. However, that doesn't mean that these currencies are criminal or bad. Just like cash isn't bad. We all have cash in our pockets, or at least we used to. Now, there are obvious benefits for anonymous money transactions that criminals like. But there's also clear benefits to the innovations we've seen in cryptocurrency space or in the blockchain space in general. But it's also good to realize that criminals understand the benefits of cryptocurrencies probably better than anyone else. Criminals go where the money is. Now, money used to be in banks. But breaking into banks is hard. Hacking into a large bank's computer systems to steal money from the bank, it's doable, it has been done, it isn't very commonplace because it's hard. What we see happening much more is that criminals don't hack the bank, they hack the bank's customers. Because that's much easier. Especially home users are really easy to hack. And as you know, home users do their banking from their home computers. And their home computers are running Windows XP, which is not very hard to hack. So if banks are a good target because they have the money, but they are sort of a tough target because they've been around for decades or hundreds of years, they have thousands of people worrying about security, it's no wonder that criminals target cryptocurrency exchanges instead. Because cryptocurrency exchanges also have the money. The amount of money they have is surprisingly large, and these organizations have not been around for hundreds of years. They don't have thousands of people. Their company is a startup. Let me give you an example. Bitstamp, which is a local cryptocurrency exchange run from here in Luxembourg, or based in Luxembourg and Slovenia, which is a place where you can exchange euros to Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies and the other way around. It's a website. So how big is this business? Well, they have 3.5 million users. Their annual trading volume last year was 35 billion euros. Let me repeat that. 35 billion euros is what they did in turnover, in trading volume. I don't know what's the trading annual volume for the Luxembourg Stock Exchange. But it's somewhere in the region, gotta be somewhere in the region. And this is a startup, all right? So is this a tempting target for an attacker? Well, of course it is, because that's where the money is. It's a much easier target than traditional banks or financial systems. And the best part, if you gain access to the funds, it's already laundered. It's already untrackable. It's already anonymous. And yes, Bitstamp was hacked in 2015 when they lost 19,000 bitcoins, which with today's exchange rate is around 90 million euros. Yeah. So criminals go where the money is. They go after the easy targets. That's the attackers who are after money. And when they target computers, we have to change our point of view of what computers look like. Because today, computers look like this. A computer, a computer, a computer. The one in the center is, that's a doorbell. And right now, the easiest way to gain access to your home network might be your digital doorbell. When we think about the risks of somebody hacking into our home-connected devices, like our smart fridges or smart coffee machines, people typically like brush away the very easily. You know, it's a smart fridge, so it's a computer, it's on the internet. I like that my fridge is smart, because when I'm doing shopping in my shop, I can look inside my fridge, because the fridge has a camera, and I can see if I'm missing any milk. So that actually is a useful thing to have a smart fridge. But people aren't worried about their fridge getting hacked because it's a goddamn fridge. Like, even if my fridge gets hacked, I don't care, it's a fridge. Well, the attackers are not interested in your fridge. They're interested in the network behind the fridge. The easiest way to your home network is your smart fridge or your smart doorbell. The easiest way to your corporate network is your smart printer or smart coffee machine. This is the way attackers gain access to internal networks. They don't care about the device. They are looking for the weakest link. And the weakest link in your corporate network is an IoT device. The weakest link in your home network is an IoT device. And we know this because we track the amount of botnets that do not infect computers at all. So our timeline for botnets that don't infect computers is growing bigger and bigger. These are all botnets which only infect security cameras and coffee machines and things like that. So this is the IoT revolution. And in fact, the IoT revolution, or the revolution of connected devices, started already years and years ago, started actually from factories and plants, from factory automation systems. If you look at companies like Siemens, they started building factory automation systems already in the 1970s and 80s. Today, any factory is run by computers, run by boxes like that. That's a PLC. This one is S7400. It happens to be the exact type of a PLC which was hacked by Stuxnet, the US-Israeli-made malware which infected Siemens PLCs in Iran, the ones which were spinning the uranium centrifuges in Iran. And you go to any factory today and you'll find that their operations are run by PLCs made by Siemens or Honeywell or Schneider or any of these large manufacturers. And we got a good reminder of what that means last week. Because last week on Monday, we got headlines from Norway, from Norsk Hydro, the second largest company in Norway, an aluminium manufacturer, which has aluminium factories around the world, including in Norway, in Qatar, in Brazil, and elsewhere. And on Monday last week, when people got to work, they saw notes on their doors telling them that please don't turn on your computers, because they had just been hit by a piece of ransomware, which had stopped all of their computing devices. And initially, this worried people a lot, because aluminium manufacturing process is very fragile. If you have to stop in an unplanned manner, you might lose the whole factory permanently. And this isn't just theoretical. This actually has happened last month. If you've been reading news about Venezuela, they've had big problems with their infrastructure, including extended electricity cuts. And as an end result of those electricity cuts, Venezuela lost all of their aluminium capability. They won't be able to make any aluminium in the whole country. They lost it last month. They expect to regain it next year. Now, this did not happen in Norway. It did not happen with Norsk Hydro. Why? They lost all their computers. Every single PLC, every single computer controlling their factories and plants was lost. Yet, there was no catastrophic failure. Why? Because of these guys. They still have old employees who remember how to run the systems without computers. Old guys who went back to the papers and binders and found the instructions and were able to calculate how to do what they used to be doing before PLCs, before computers. They were still able to do this. I think these guys just earned their pension. But how much longer will we be able to do this? 5 years, 10 years, 15? And this is now a problem the world over, because today every company is a software company. Every company is a software company. Your company is a software company. It doesn't matter what you do. It's a software company anyway. Because today the difference between successful and unsuccessful companies is how good you are in digitalization. And when we are trying to defend our organizations and our networks against attackers, you don't actually have to have perfect security. There is no perfect security. But most attackers are after money. And when someone is after money and they try to break into your network, they're not really interested in hacking you or your company. They're not interested in you. They're interested in money. Which means if it's too hard, too slow, too expensive to gain access to your network, they will forget about you and will go after an easier target. They will go after the low-hanging fruit. And believe me when I tell you that the internet is a garden of low-hanging fruits. So you don't have to have perfect security. You just have to have a little bit better security than the average if you are fighting criminals. But if you happen to be working for an organization which is being targeted by foreign governments, foreign militaries, or foreign agencies, then everything changes. Because those guys will not give up. They typically work for a military organization, and they've been given an order. And the order is, go and break into that company, steal that information, report back when you've done it. Go. That's the command. And what these guys are good at is following commands. If they can't get in, they're not going to change their mind that, you know, we couldn't get in, let's go after someone else. No, they will try again and again until they get in. And if that's the kind of enemy you're fighting, that's a very hard fight to fight. And if that's the kind of enemy to fight, then the best hope you have is stop thinking about your network like a safe or like a fortress where you're just building thick walls around your network and hoping that nobody ever gets in. Because we can only imagine a limited amount of ways of breaking into our network, and there are unlimited ways to break in. We know this because we run incident response teams. And whenever we get a phone call to our incident response teams, the phone call is typically a call of panic. Like, help me, we're hacked, can you come right away and help us? So we go right away, we take a look at their network, and then we tell them that, yes, you're right, you're hacked. But you were hacked last year. Like, there's no rush here, we come back next week. When we look at the statistics on how long it takes for an organization to realize they've been hacked, it's in the weeks, in the months, in many cases it takes years before they realize they've been hacked. So when you are building defenses for your network, when you're getting ready for a cyber attack, yes, you do want to build the walls around your network. You want to have the thick walls, thick doors, great locks. And if you have thick walls and doors and great lock around your network, then you don't really need a motion detector inside, do you? I mean, nobody's going to get in. Why would you put a motion detector inside? Well, that's exactly what you should be doing. You should be assuming that the thick doors and locks will fail. And if they fail, then it's actually very, very nice that you have a motion detector inside, even though you think you will never need it. The day that it trips, you love the fact that you had a motion detector. And this is where most companies are failing today. They're building the firewalls, the proxies, the filters, the gateways, and hoping that they will keep every single attacker out forever. And then when they fail, it's going to take them weeks, months, and years to realize that they failed. We should be doing much better in detecting breaches and much better in reacting to breaches. Because the fact is that the internet is not a utopia. For us, defending the security and privacy of the internet users, it has become closer and closer to a nightmare. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Took the words out of my mouth, from utopia to nightmare. I will repeat them. Do we have any questions? No. Okay. We do. Question for you. If the previous speaker, Dr. Suskin, considers that technology today is the worst it will ever be, do you think there will be a time when the cyber fight will be lost?
Well, we're losing fights every single day. So yeah. The way we defenders think about our daily fights is that we're trying to focus on identifying the key points that the attackers are using against us, the key benefits they have over us, and then we try to somehow mitigate those points. I'll give you an example. Attackers who create backdoors, trojans, malware, they know that if they want to escape detection of security systems, all they have to do is to create a completely new, unique piece of malware, which we've never seen before, because security systems block known attacks. So they just create unique new attacks, which have never been seen before, and they will go through. Well, we thought about that, and we now started building systems which are based on reputation-based detection, which basically means that if you're running security system on your computer and you get hit by a completely new piece of malware on your system, we will scan it for known malware, we'll analyze it any way we can, and we won't find anything bad. But then we will realize, based on our reputation-based system, that you are the first person on the planet who's running this program. This program has never been run anywhere else. And that's a bit weird. I mean, that should normally never happen. Why are you the first person on the planet running this program? And we will actually stop the program just based on that. We don't find anything bad from it. We don't know anything about the program except that it's unique, which means we take exactly what the attackers are doing to try to bypass our detection, and we're using that to block them. And I like defenses like that, where we take the attacker's strength and we use that against the attackers themselves.
So new ways of thinking. Always need to be thinking in new ways, as you say. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you.